Welcome to GFN's Face2Face, right here on GFN 98.7 FM in Gwangju and 93.7 FM in Yeosu. It's 7 p.m. on Sunday night, and I'm your host, Darlo Mattis. Face2Face is a program about meeting great local people in our daily lives. The people we meet on this program are our neighbors, but they have something unique to share with us. These are the great stories of ordinary people, and you can join us every Sunday at this hour. Eunhee Park was born in Wonsan, North Korea. Eunhee escaped North Korea when she was 21. She finally arrived in South Korea in 2012, but she faced difficult times. However, her life completely changed. In 2018, she had a speech at TEDx about the lives of North Korean women and at the Asia Liberty Forum. Her life could improve after she met these two wonderful guests we have tonight. Tonight we have Casey Lartigue Jr. and Eunkoo Lee, who are presidents of Freedom Speakers International. In part one, we're going to chat about before they started their organization and how they began their journey. Then in the second half of the show, we're going to dive deeply into Freedom Speakers International's projects and some other stories of North Korean refugees like Park Eunhee. So stick around. Thanks for tuning in this evening on Face2Face. We'll be right back after Strange Relationship by Prince. Welcome, listeners. I'd like to introduce our two special guests tonight. We have Casey Lartigue Jr. and Eunkoo. For our listeners, could you both introduce yourselves briefly?
Ladies first.
Hello, my name is Eunkoo Lee. Mm-hmm. I'm a South Korean, and I'm a co-founder of and co-president of Freedom Speakers International.
All right. Well, Eunkoo, thank you so much for joining us today. It's a pleasure to meet you.
Thank you for inviting me.
Okay, I'm Casey Lartigue Jr. I'm an American living and working in Seoul, South Korea, co-founder and co-president of FSI, along with Eunkoo Lee.
Well, Casey, thank you so much for joining us today. Thank you for joining us both all the way from Seoul, right?
Yes.
Your office is up in Seoul, but you came all the way down to Gwangju to join us here.
Mm.
Have you been in Gwangju before?
First time.
Really?
Yes.
Oh, okay.
No, I have been here like several times for my business trip in previous job.
All right.
And then the first time I ate yukjeon.
Oh.
Yeah, in Gwangju, and I came here. So I found a new food, like a yukjeon here.
It's delicious, isn't it?
Yeah, it's right. Yeah, it's really delicious.
Right. Yeah, not all the regional delicacies are to everyone's taste, like hongap, but, you know, the yukjeon's good stuff.
Mm.
And Casey, this is your first time here, so welcome to our city.
Thank you so much.
Now, before we talk about your organization, we're going to listen to a little bit about your backgrounds.
Mm.
Why don't you start, Casey? What did you do before FSI?
Let's see. I used to be an education policy analyst at the Cato Institute in Washington, D.C.
Wow.
And there I also hosted a radio show on XM 169 of Power, the Casey Lartigue Show.
Really?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
So you're a veteran.
Well, yeah, but I got fired, so I can't.
Okay.
Yes. But also I was the co-editor of a book on educational freedom.
Okay.
And also in South Korea, I was the director for international relations of Freedom Factory Company, as mm-hmm. well as the Center for Free Enterprise. And I also have been a columnist with the Korea Times now for 7 years.
Wow. Okay. Yes. That's a pretty, broad resume you've got
right.
there.
Exactly.
A lot of different things, including some work in media. I'm glad you're up in Seoul. Otherwise, I'd worry that you're going to grab my chair while you're at it.
Don't worry. I can't keep a job, so it's okay.
Oh, okay. All right. Fair enough. Eunkoo, what about you?
Before I start in the FSI, I working at the researcher, one of the Korean research institute called as Talbuk Chongsunyeon Gyuk Jiwon Center, which is that the support North Korean refugee youth people.
Mm-hmm.
And then for 5 years, and before that I was working at the one of the NGO for publishing North Korean human rights report for 5 years. But before that, my academic background also related to North Korean things,
mm-hmm.
such as I studied master degree for North Korean studies.
Wow.
And the international studies. So all academic background, and then my all working careers are related to North Korean unification things.
That's fascinating. I did an essay when I was in school on North Korea's economic development.
Oh, okay.
It was really interesting to try to research.
Yeah, right.
Because it's not easy.
But completely different.
You don't get internal data so much.
Yeah.
And if you do, it's not that neutral. Now, Casey, You know, I'd be remiss for our listeners if I didn't mention that we have a Harvard University graduate.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
Here in our studio today. You might be the first one we've had. Now, whoa. Casey, that's very impressive. But what got you interested in North Korea? Was it academic?
Well, first of all, I feel like I should change my name to Harvard Lartigue or Casey Harvard, because it always gets talked about by South Koreans.
Right, in Korea, right. Yes.
Yeah, so, and actually one Korean newspaper called me the Black Harvard Graduate Helping North Koreans.
Yes.
Yeah, wow. So, yes. Yeah. Okay.
Even if we didn't mention the race, mm-hmm. but they just put the black.
Yes. Right.
Right.
Yeah. That's sort of bizarre.
Yeah, it's happened many times, though.
Right.
So,
yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
But,
okay.
But as far as North Korean refugees, I came here as a visiting fellow at one of the research institutes.
Okay.
And I met some North Korean refugees at that time. Mm-hmm. And I didn't really think I could do anything at first, but I just realized that I had a role.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But I think probably the key moment is meeting them. I felt so humble because I had been focused on freedom for so long as a researcher and somewhat mm-hmm. of an activist in the USA. But now I was meeting people who actually had to escape to freedom
right.
at the risk of death.
Yeah.
So, yeah, that opened my eyes and I tried to do something to get involved.
Mm. Right. Yeah. Like it'd be like if you studied, you know, poverty, and then you were working with people that were actually had struggled being poor their whole lives.
Right.
You know, you worked and met with people that had, like, you know, fought and struggled for the most basic of freedoms.
Right. Yeah. Exactly. And then just so what really happened was that in early 2012, about 30 North Korean refugees had gotten captured in China. They were going to be sent back to North Korea, mm-hmm. and there they could be executed, tortured. Family members could also be killed.
Uh-huh. Mm-hmm.
And I remember just thinking that this is crazy. Mm-hmm. You know, I started to learn about North Korea, mm-hmm. so I joined protests in front of the Chinese embassy mm-hmm. for a couple of months.
Wow.
But there was one politician who held a hunger strike in front of her. Her name was Park Sun-young.
Mm-hmm.
And I remember just looking at her and saying, you know what? I can do more,
uh-huh.
and I will do more.
Wow.
And so I got involved with the school that she set up for North Korean refugee children. But another thing that happened that day is that I met a North Korean refugee who wanted to tell her story in English.
Mm-hmm.
And her name is Lee Hun-so.
Right.
And we started working together. And 1 year later, she gave the first TED Talk by a North Korean refugee. And I was her main mentor for that. So those two things mm-hmm. inspired me that, you know what, I can really do more.
Mm. Well, and you have been. And we thank you. It's a very important thing,
yeah.
you know. And we thank both of you for working on this. Now, you know, when you're children, what kind of role models did you have that made you, you know, interested in going down this kind of path?
Well, I'm also I'm not the finding of my role model. I'm just thinking is that what I can do for my nation, my country.
Okay.
It's just South Korean.
Mm-hmm.
Then one of the big mission, like unification.
Oh.
That the point that how can I help or how can I contribute on the unification in two countries? Mm-hmm. Then I realized that I should learn about the North Korea.
Mm-hmm.
So that's why I studied the North Korean studies. So more like I didn't find my role model, more like I find what I can do.
Okay.
At my situation.
Uh-huh.
So that is the unification is very fascinating to me
mm-hmm.
and how can help. And I study the North Korean studies and I keep working related to North Korean issue. Then finally I met Casey.
All right.
And then I working at these nice activities.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
But as you said, it started with a goal to serve your own country.
Yeah, right.
So did
yeah.
somebody instill that nationalism in you?
The importance
of helping your own country?
I'm not saying that the nationalism, but through my education, that I love my country.
Right.
Then
I should say it's patriotism.
Right.
This isn't nationalism.
Right, yeah, okay, yeah.
It's a big difference.
Yeah, yeah, right. So, I mean, it's just South Korean. I don't know why, where is it from, that kind of thought.
Mm-hmm.
But, I mean, just naturally, I want to just contribute to my
yeah.
nation. Yeah, so maybe my parents.
Okay.
yeah.
Well, yeah, they must
yeah,
have
right.
done a good
yeah,
job.
Right.
Yeah, I mean, yeah. you know, any time, you know, everything
yeah.
from even if I hold the door open for Zona, it's
right.
all because of what
yeah.
my parents taught me.
Yeah.
It would have been natural for me.
yeah.
Now, What about you, Casey?
I won't say role model, but definitely influenced by Mark Twain and Frederick Douglass.
Oh.
Those are the ones that I read when I was young. I read everything by them. Mm-hmm. Mark Twain, just because of the humor and analysis, it was just interesting to me. Mm-hmm. And Frederick Douglass, I read all... So he was a former slave who became a leading abolitionist, mm-hmm. Speaking out against slavery and being active against it. I read all three of his books when I was 12 years old. And I even convinced my parents to drive from Missouri City, Texas, where I grew up, to Washington, D.C., which is about 1,400 miles, so I could visit the home, his final home.
Wow.
Which is now, I guess, kind of like a museum in his honor. And then later on, you know, I gave the keynote address to the organization carrying on his legacy and joined the Board of Trustees. So I've always had this long connection with this idea of focusing on freedom, mm-hmm. Focusing on the importance of the individual,
okay.
and the importance of locomotion, that people have the right to move.
Wow. Hmm. That's a role model, right? That's inspirational. How did you two meet?
Oh, well, it's a long time ago. I think 2012, September that the... one of the big North Korean human rights conference in Seoul. So I was a volunteer who helped the foreigners to guide the seat and something helping the English for the foreign the audiences. And
okay.
Casey, I think, came to as an audience.
I was going from conference right. and event to event, so just trying to get involved.
Right. So we met the International North Korean Human Rights Conference in 2012, I think.
Oh, that's very cool. All right. Mm-hmm. Well, I want to hear more about this. We're going to be right back, listeners. We're going to listen to a song Casey chose. This is Salt and Pepa's live performance from Spring Break James in 1994. I haven't heard this song in years. This is What a Man. All right, we've got Casey and Eunkoo here from FSI, which stands for?
Freedom Speakers International.
That's right. And we're talking about how you started this group. And we're talking about its involvement with North Korea. But I have a question. Have you ever been to North Korea?
Yes.
You have?
Yeah, I have once, like in 2009 or something. For that time in Korea, South Korean government were like try to resolving more good relationship with North Korea.
Right.
So one of the group to monitoring the humanitarian aid that South Korean government supported.
Okay.
So I was huge group, like 100 people.
Wow.
As a group, so I visit and I kind of pay a lot. I remember that.
Uh-huh.
Then I'm just, it was a kind of very new experience for me because the North Korea is an imaginary country for me.
Mm-hmm.
But I can check and I can see the people.
Yeah.
But unfortunately, I have no freedom to travel what I want.
Right.
I'm just always find the security guard.
Mm-hmm.
What they said. But one thing I remember that before I going to North Korea, that they always remind that don't criticize the government.
Sure.
Then you make your trouble.
Uh-huh.
So please just talking general thing and praise.
Mm-hmm.
Not praise, but it's more like a positive things rather than the criticizing things. Yeah.
Down here, it's almost the opposite.
Yeah, right.
I don't think I've heard anyone ever say anything nice about any government here the whole time I've been here.
Yeah, but I couldn't say anything what I really feel.
Of course.
Yeah, so I mean, good experience for me because I'm working with North Korean refugees, so I can see where they're from.
All right.
Yeah.
And Casey, what about you?
No.
All right.
And I won't go.
Fair, I understand.
Yeah, I won't go until North Koreans are free to come here. Mm-hmm. And I've also talked to some people who've gone, and they'll tell me how great it was and that the people that they met, it was so fantastic. And my question is, can you call them?
Right.
Can you send them a letter?
Yeah.
Can you contact them in any way?
Mm-hmm.
So I won't go. And for me, it's almost thinking about like American slavery. I cannot imagine people taking like tours to plantations as slaves are working in the fields and they're not free. So for me, it's just like, I'm never going to go.
I understand.
And I will welcome people when they come here, though.
Mm-hmm. I think that's a really good comparison.
Mm.
Yeah, but there's a government invite me, so I
can
go.
Yeah.
We used to debate about this,
right,
by the way.
Well, sure.
You know, she told me about it, and I was like, it's okay, it's your money.
Yeah, well, and I think it's also different because for you, you're Korean.
Right, yeah.
You're Korean, right?
Yeah.
It helped you develop that perspective.
Yeah, right.
And it is what you studied.
Mm. Mm.
Now, let's talk about your organization. Let's start with that. And then we'll talk about how you guys started it. FSI, tell me about it.
Sure. So it's a nice little nonprofit We have official organizational status in both the USA and South Korea. We started back in March of 2013. But it was just like a hobby because Eunkoo was working at a government agency and I was working for a small little think tank here in town. And the main purpose is to empower North Korean refugees. We started off with English and we expanded to include public speaking. We added mentoring to that also. But now we just focus on public speaking.
Okay.
So it was just volunteering the weekends. But when we the developing FSI, but before that we called it TNKR, Teaching North Korean Refugees. But between Casey and I, we have a lot of a conflict. Is it especially to the approach to help North Korean refugees? And because of my old background, it's more like a top-down approach to help someone. I'm grew up in South Korea, and I'm really used to that, the top-down state
Center. So things go down the hierarchy.
So I really believe that the way to North Korean refugees should be we provide everything from the top-down. But Casey actually suggests that we should go to the bottom-up. But I don't believe that because North Korean refugees, they came to new society and they should learn. So as a South Korean, we should help them to guide everything. But the Casey said that, no, we give a chance to choose. Then they can decide their life. But which is, for example, the way to the North Korean refugees choose their volunteer or mentors, we give a right to choose what they want. I mean, the volunteers. So they can choose their volunteer that they can study. But I said, no, that is not right way. We should match after we look at the resumes. So that is a big conflict between Casey and I. But after I feedback from North Korean refugees, I realized that I was wrong. I was wrong.
Mark the date, Casey. Mark the date.
She was wrong. Yeah, she didn't listen to me. And she was never going to listen to me. As she said, it wasn't until the refugees told her, oh, we love to choose the teachers. And that's so great. And they could choose as many as they wanted. And then finally, Eunkoo came to me. Oh, yeah, maybe that works out better after all.
This sounds just like what happens when I have an idea that my wife doesn't like. I need somebody else to say, that we like the way Arlo did it. Now, that's really interesting because it's about freedom, right? And you're giving them a choice. But when you've never chosen anything. You don't always know what to do. Like, even having a choice, you know, is it a test?
And that's what so many of them told us that, I mean, like, I never heard of this kind of thing. And working with the South Korean organizations is top-down, just like the kind that Eunkoo learned. So it was definitely something different for
them. But I saw many cases that refugees who join our program, they really enjoy that their freedom to choose. And they really, because they choose their mentors or volunteers, so they have their responsibility for their classes. So that is the main point.
You know, they've got a stake in it, right? They're engaged.
You know what? I really wish I could take Eunkoo back into a time machine because this is exactly the kind of thing I was saying. That they have to choose, and if they choose, they can't blame anybody else.
It's good that you know, because you two have a dynamic and differing perspectives.
I'm sure
that's helped your organization be successful.
Usually.
By evolving. Now, you know, when you're helping North Koreans, do you find there's some differences in learning styles between them and South Koreans? Are there some different approaches you have to take?
So my understanding, the learning English between South and North Koreans that South Koreans also, I mean, English is important for everyone, I think. Global language. But the North Korean who, I mean, whatever their background, even though they graduate university or top university, I mean, they still need English. So I think the starting point is really different. Like, they are, even if they are very high academic background in North Korea, but still, they should learn English. So I think starting point is different between North Korean refugees and South Koreans. So North Koreans, it's important learning English because it's all Konglish in here. So, yeah, it's different.
All right. Fair enough. Casey, have you noticed any?
Well, I would agree with that. And I would just add that there is a higher level of desperation for North Korean refugees. Mm. So when they first come in to South Korea, so many of them are told you need to learn English. Mm. And so many of them, when they will find us, people keep telling me I need English, but I don't know why. But after like a year or two, they'll come back and it's like lions chasing deer. Mm-hmm. I mean, they're like, where are those teachers? I need to learn English now.
All right.
Hey, so after they've had some experience in South Korea, applying for universities, applying for jobs, just trying to get into the general life, and these Konglish words keep popping up, and they don't know what they are.
Right.
So they learn.
Okay. Mm-hmm. It helps, I see. Well, we're going to take a short break. We're going to listen to one more song. This is James Brown's Talking Loud and Saying Nothing. We'll be right back with Face to Face. We're back with more stories in part two. If you're just joining us, we've got two special guests who help North Korean refugees. We've got Casey and Eunkoo here tonight. Now, actually, I wanted to ask you in the last section, we didn't have time. I wanted to know your organization, FSI, which stands for?
Freedom Speakers International.
All right. How do North Korean refugees come to you?
They find us through word of mouth. Haven't had to recruit any North Korean refugees, and that was the test that I said that we had to pass, and that is, could we establish a program that was so effective that they would come looking for us?
Mm-hmm.
And that's exactly what happened. So the first year, of course, we had to recruit, but after a couple of months, they're knocking on our door.
Really?
They're calling us. They're looking for us. Even like Eunkoo would get direct phone calls.
Wow.
And some of them who are brave would call me directly.
Uh-huh.
They're finding me on Facebook. And so all kinds, I suddenly get Kakao messages. Mm. So all kinds of ways that they will find us.
So it's basically refugee who join our program, then recommend to other North Korean refugees. Yeah. To join this program.
Yeah, and I want to make one, and again, Eunkoo worked at the government agency where they had to go chasing North Korean refugees, remind them.
Well, this is an ad-driven society, right?
Yeah, right.
Like everywhere, it's about, advertising.
But we didn't have to do that.
Wow. Yeah,
so
they
come looking for us. And I mean, I want to tell a very quick story. We had one refugee. So we'd have our sessions 2 p.m. on Saturday once a month where the refugees could choose their tutors.
The previous program.
The previous program. And then we had one refugee who showed up at our office at 1 a.m. because she could register and she would be able to choose first.
Mm.
Wow.
She was so eager. And we had so many refugees like that that they just couldn't wait to start.
Mm.
That's keen.
Yeah, so we didn't have an issue at all with
I wish I had students with that kind of that kind of grit and determination. Now, you taught English to North Korean refugees.
We did.
Though I understand there's been a bit of pivot from that during during the pandemic, right?
Right. Mm.
But so what are some of your other focuses?
Well, main focus is on public speaking. So the name is Freedom Speakers International. And that includes a couple of things, such as publishing books, speeches, participating in conferences. And also we have like some pop-up events where a refugee might have a special focus, such as cooking. So we put on an event where the refugee could give a cooking class in English.
Cool.
Yes, all kinds of things.
All right.
Yes.
Do you have anything you can add to that?
No, yeah, it's the same thing. Like we have the conference, most of the webinar or the online stuff, and
all right.
Yeah, still we are finding opportunity for North Korean refugees to give up and to speak out.
Sure.
Their stories, their speeches.
Well, send some down to us.
Sure.
I would love to be able to, interview.
Wow, great.
North Korea on the show.
Oh,
that would be great.
Mm. Yeah. So.
You know, it'd be intense. I would love to.
Okay.
You know, send some of your better students.
Mm.
Tell them it's a contest.
Yeah.
There we go. There we go.
Okay.
Now, Casey, I heard you're helping publish a book.
Mm.
Oh, that's right.
So, Green Light to Freedom.
Green Light to Freedom.
I like that name. What's this?
Yes. Well, it's a North Korean refugee. Her name is Songmi Han.
Mm.
And actually, very interesting story. This is her 10th year of freedom. She escaped 10 years ago. And for the first 9, she never talked about being from North Korea. But she joined our program and started to get more comfortable, started to settle down in her life, and decided that, you know what? She came to me and said that I'd like to tell my story, but you're the only person in the world that I trust to do it correctly.
Wow.
So, I couldn't say no. So we're working on a book right now, and it will be published in February 2022. People can go to our website, FSI21.org, they can pre-order it, which will really make her happy to know that people are waiting for her story.
Does Meehan speak English pretty well?
She does.
Get her down. Well, I'm completely serious.
Okay.
Yeah, we'll promote it. Okay. I know people here in the city. We'll have a whole event. She can give a talk at the GIC.
Okay, that sounds great.
All right, let's get this rolling. Mm. Now, you know, that's one incredible story. I bet you guys have all kinds of great stories of people that you've helped, though.
Yeah.
You can go start.
So I remember several, but one of the students is that he was our speech contest winner. And then he studied with us in English, several years. Then finally he got a scholarship from the U.S. Embassy. Mm-hmm. Then he went to the USA for studying the master degree. Mm-hmm. Then several years, he studied in USA and he joined our program, but he got a scholarship and went to USA. Uh-huh. And then after several years, he came back to Korea, finished mm-hmm. his degree. Then he came back to our organization, FSI. Then he suggested what kind of project we can work together.
Wow.
So he want to use his skills, MBA skills. Mm-hmm. So how can I helping other refugees in our organization? And he really trusts us. Mm-hmm. That's why he suggests the project that we're working with us. So I remember him that he studied and got a degree and came back to us.
Yeah.
And it's more like a leadership position to help other North Korean refugees.
Yeah.
So it's really the growth. Growing.
Absolutely.
Yeah, right, yeah.
I want to get that guy on the show, too. send him with me. With Sungmi.
Okay.
With Sungmi Han. All right. That's incredible.
Yes.
Unfortunately, that's all the time we have before our next break. We're going to listen to the great Sam Cooke with a live version of Having a Party. Stay tuned, listeners. All right. Now, we're going to talk some more about specifically what it's like being a North Korean refugee, but I understand. Casey, first, you want to share one more story from FSI.
Sure. Yeonmi Park, who published the book In Order to Live, studied in our program in 2013 and 2014, mm-hmm. published a book In Order to Live. And people may remember her. She gave the speech at One Young World that I think in the first couple of months had 82 million views of it. Mm-hmm. And I've heard it's now been more than 200 million. Mm-hmm. Well, I was her mentor for that speech and we had a podcast together.
Wow.
And now she's international. She was just on the Joe Rogan show and Jordan Peterson. And and Eunhee Park, who's in our program actively still now, she went from ABC to TED. So she was an ABC speaker just 6 years ago. And then in 2018, she gave a TEDx talk.
Right.
And we've had others who've given TEDx talks. So we've had just some incredible stories.
Those are some real milestones of success for your organization. Mm. Now, speaking about the influx of North Korean refugees here to South Korea, because those are the people that you work with, I've heard the numbers have declined during the coronavirus period, during the pandemic. Mm. So have you been affected by that?
Well, we have not been affected directly because we typically don't work with the newcomers. And it's not that we don't want to, but it's because they need to settle down first.
Right. As you mentioned, they have to go find out that English is important and so what skills they need.
Right. So, and also they're kind of boring at that point. Mm-hmm. And what I mean is that they don't really have any perspective about things. They've escaped. They know about their hometowns in North Korea.
Yeah.
After they come here, they actually learn more about North Korea than they knew when they were in the country. Mm-hmm. So after they've been here for a while, then they're ready for public speaking. They're ready to branch out and do other things.
I feel the same way about Waegukin teachers.
but North Korea shut the border. And in the first 6 months of this year, only 31 North Korean refugees made it to South Korea. Mm-hmm. Now, that's in comparison to 2019 or so, about 1,000 made it.
Mm. Wow.
Yeah. Mm. And but if you go back even before that, about 2,900 made it in 1 year, in the year 2009. So
this is a tiny fraction.
Just 31 people. That's it.
Mm. Wow. All right. Mm. Now, you help North Koreans not just learn English, but with life, their lives and life skills. What are some of the challenges or difficulties they face working here?
So first, definitely language issue. Between North Korea and South Korea, same language, but we are having the long time the division that we different way to the evolve the language.
Right.
So when they came here, that first phase is that the difficulty that the Konglish.
Right.
Yeah, in Korea, lots of the using English plus Korean.
Yeah. They don't say ice cream, right?
Right.
They've got a different word.
Even though you say like a human share, what does it mean? Human share is an apartment. Who can imagine?
Right.
And then also computer cleaning, you know, is a laundry thing.
Right.
But
yeah,
the,
okay.
What is a computer cleaning? Is cleaning the computer, what does it mean? So it's all like all thing is kind of the confused in language, even though same language, but okay. North Korean refugee often said that, I can't understand what South Korea said.
And that's tough as well because it identifies them as North Korean.
Yes.
Right? Mm. Like when you speak to a North Korean, you know you're speaking to
accent.
A North Korean.
I can quickly can get it.
Okay.
And also second challenge, I think, is it the perception from South Koreans because also, I mean, North Korea is, they are strongly, propaganda education against South Korean and USA especially.
Yeah.
But at the same time, in South Korea as well, I mean, North Korea is always our enemy, big enemy. So, I mean, especially old people, and then they are educated, by the, North Korea is enemy, one of the enemy for us. So when we met North Koreans, we are, same people, but at the same time, mixed feeling that they are also enemy. So some South Koreans have many South Koreans have a perception about that. Also, young people actually not interested in this issue. So it feel like North Koreans feel like lonely and discrimination by South Koreans as well.
For sure. I can understand. Now, I've got a kind of contemporary issue to talk about.
I wanted to add something to that.
Go ahead.
So in North Korea, the North Koreans are powerless. In South Korea, I would say that many of them are vulnerable. And we have an issue because about 72% of the refugees are females and uneducated and struggling in many ways, unfamiliar with the South Korean system. And a lot of the single moms in particular are really struggling. Mm. So we try to provide some support, but obviously we're limited in what we can do.
All right. Well, again, that's something, you know, I'm sure there's people here in the city that would like to be able to help in some way if it's possible. Mm. Now, speaking about a kind of contemporary issue, the South Korean National Assembly approved legislation that imposes stiff fines and even jail terms for sending material across the border by balloons. Mm. This was going up in Paju, right, where you're from.
Yes.
And, you know, they were sending, money and leaflets and different things. And the United States, which, you know, has a sort of emphasis in its political culture on freedom of speech and expression, has been critical about this. I'm kind of curious about what you guys think about it, your perspective on that.
Well, you know what? I've gone and helped send the air balloons to North Korea, and I've also helped send CDs and DVDs into North Korea. So I'm completely opposed to the restriction on it.
Right.
So now, doesn't mean that it's necessarily good, but I don't see why North Koreans, the ones who are here, trying to send information into the country that they were born in, and I don't see why they should be stopped.
Okay. Eunkoo, you feel the same?
Oh, well, I don't know about the issue, but they're very sensitive.
It is.
Sensitive.
It is. Yeah. I think, you know, it's tricky, right? Because freedom of speech doesn't mean you're free to yell fire at a movie theater.
Mm.
And it does, you know, if when tensions are inflamed, it can put some people at risk, too. So that's why it's tricky.
But, you know, it's so ironic to me that for North Koreans, they're not allowed to possess that information that's because of North Korea. But then they're not allowed to send it from here either.
Right. Yep.
Yeah. So it's like on both sides, they're saying you can't transfer information into the country.
But I believe that thing is it is in Korea is a free society, so we cannot block the people what they want. And then I really believe that North Korean refugees the most person who really know and understand well about North Korean society. So
it's hard to argue with that.
Yeah. So is it maybe that group, North Korean refugees, the most person that they know, then maybe the reason to doing something that, but we cannot block what they want. Yeah.
Well, you've given us something to think about. Now we're going to listen to Last Day of School by the Wild Bunch before our final conversation. All right. We're going to finish up here with Casey and Eunkoo. They're going to share some of their plans for the future and tell us what we can do as a local community. Let's start with FSI. What are some plans or goals?
Number one, we're working on about five books with North Korean refugees. Yeah. Well, four of them, seriously. Yeah. The fifth one is starting up.
Okay.
Events, well, that depends on funding. Because we held two large events early this year after we did receive some support, but those are pending now. Mm-hmm. We're always looking for platforms for North Korean refugees to speak, but I want to be clear that we like to have external partners involved, not just someone saying, I got a Zoom link and, you know, send me to refugees. So we'd like something more elaborate for them, more official. Mm-hmm. And we're always looking for partnerships because we need to grow as an organization.
Mm. Okay. Mm. Fair enough. Eunkoo, any?
No, I mean, we just changed the name in DC earlier this year. So we need to more advertise and promote the new name of Freedom Speakers International.
All right.
So, yeah, we want more people to know about us.
Give me a link. I'll throw it down there on the webpage when we air this here.
FSI21.org.
Yeah. Okay, there we go. I wanted to hear something like that. Mm. Now, what do you think freedom means, like, to you?
Well, for me, it's a choice. I never thought of the freedom that I already given. But through the North Korean refugee stories, I heard that, I mean, freedom is not free. So I learned that. And then one refugee, I remember that the most difficult for gaining freedom is the choice. When they went to the grocery shop, then what kind of the banana the refugee can choose, because so many variety choice. Mm-hmm. So freedom meaning that I can choose what I want. Yeah. So, but choice, but also I think at the same time is a freedom, is a responsibility. Mm. So it's only not just do what I want, but also I have a responsibility for protect and preserve my freedom.
Right.
So, yeah.
I really wish I could take you back in a time machine. Yeah. Choice, absolutely. That's what I've been saying for years. Okay. Choice is the key thing. And for me, when I wake up in the morning, am I able to do the thing that I want to do? That's what freedom is to me. And if I don't like something, that I can walk away from it. Mm. You might have a great idea. I should be able to say no. Mm. That's what freedom is to me.
Spoken like a bachelor. Now, what do you think we can do as a local community to help North Korean refugees?
Okay, so it's hard to give advice to people who I don't know who they are. But something Frederick Douglass said is that the tools to those who can use them. Figure out the skills that you have and apply them. Because it's hard for me to just say, hey, why don't you do this? Why don't you do that? And I might say, for example, you need to send information into North Korea. I have no idea how to do that. You need to teach English to them. Well, I don't really want to teach English. Well, you need to help the single moms. Well, I don't really want to do that. Mm-hmm. So that means that you need to do some investigation on your own.
Right.
And after about a year, you will figure out the best way you can make a difference.
It starts with learning.
There you go. Right. Exactly. Learning, getting involved directly, and then you'll find your own way. And that's what happened with us.
Right.
I mean, we didn't just start immediately. It took us some time also to figure out what worked with us.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, and then before I coming to Gwangju, that I some research about that, how many refugees, North Korean refugees living in Gwangju, and now a total like 580 or 70 the living in Gwangju. Mm-hmm. And then Gwangju also the one of the Gwangju Hana Center where that the Ministry of Education to set up the some community center for only for North Korean refugees.
Right.
So, I mean, the people in Gwangju who are interested in helping North Korean refugees, I mean, they can some the connection with Hana Center, then they can help.
Yeah, we've given some news about that center before. On the show here, but you know, at the same time, I don't know how much participation goes on. Well, you know, we're just about out of time, so I've just got to say thank you so much for coming down all the way from Seoul, and for sharing this with us, and also thank you for the good work that you're doing.
Thank you so much.
Thank you for having us.
That's all for this episode of Face to Face. Tonight's guests were Casey and Eunkoo, who are co-founders and co-presidents of Freedom Speakers International. They do incredible work for North Korean refugees here. Thank you to them for all the help they do, and thank you to you for tuning into our show tonight. I'm Marlo Mattis. We'll be waiting with more interesting stories every Sunday evening at 7 p.m. on GFN, 98.7 FM in Gwangju and 93.7 FM in Yeosu. We'll leave you now with our last song, Johnny Kemp's Just Got Paid, requested by tonight's guest, Casey. See you next week.